Hello, everyone.
Hi, welcome.
I'm gonna do this while I speak. Is that a little hat? All right, thank you. Welcome everybody here, everybody tuning in via Crowdcast. Thank you all so much for joining us at Woodland Pattern. And my name is Mike Wendt. I'm the program director here. I had to look at my paper to tell you my name. My name is Mike Wendt. I'm the program director here at Woodland Pattern. And I just wanted to begin with a land acknowledgement and say that we acknowledge that in Milwaukee, we live and work on traditional Potawatomi, Ho-Chunk, and Menominee homelands along the southwest shores of Michigami, part of North America's largest system of freshwater lakes, where the Milwaukee, Menominee, and Kinnickinnick rivers meet, and the people of Wisconsin's sovereign Anishinaabe, Ho-Chunk, Menominee, Oneida, and Mohican nations remain present. We further acknowledge the grave evil colonialism introduced to these lands through genocide as well as slavery, but also via racist and xenophobic beliefs, laws, and practices that continue to inflict harm upon Black, Brown, and Indigenous lives. We honor those who have lived and do live now at these intersections of identity and experience and are committed to the active dismantling of white supremacy. And then I want to turn things over to Nakeysha, but before I do, I want to say thank you so much, Nakeysha. an appropriate level of enthusiasm. Thank you. That was in genre urban arts, and of course, Akindele for allowing us to host this amazing work. It's been fantastic to have this in the gallery. And again, of course, to you all for celebrating, and to everyone who's taking part. You'll hear more about that when I turn things over to Nakeysha. But thank you. Welcome, Nakeysha.
Thank you. Nobody ever believes that I'm a very shy person because I put on like my teacher persona. But thank you so much all for being here. And those of you who are in different parts of the world, thank you for being here. First, I would like to thank Woodland Pattern for hosting us and having this event here. Woodland Pattern is one of the first places when I started genre urban arts that actually supported me sincerely and gave me a space to host events. So I'm always thankful and in debt to this particular space. I was very thankfully invited to be a board member of this wonderful space about a year ago. So I'm very proud of that, to be able to help out with this wonderful establishment that really actually supports creatives in Milwaukee. So thank you. I love you. And so I'm the owner and founder of Genre Urban Arts. Pretty much everybody here knows me, but if you don't, Genre Urban Arts is a local publishing company and an educational consulting agency. We host events. This is actually the first event that I've hosted and organized since the pandemic because I'm a big chicken and I didn't want to have any events, but the world is what it is, so we are here today. And so some of the things that Genre Urban Arts does is we host workshops, we publish magazines, we have our number 11 signature print that's gonna come out, be ready and available really soon with the newest work from Akindele, so I'm very excited about that. And we do a whole bunch of other things. Look us up online, check us out. So I wanna read a little bit about Akindele, the artist here with these wonderful works. Another thank you to Woodland Pattern for organizing and bringing these works all the way from Nigeria here. And thank you, Marla, for all of the work that you did. Marla is back there. Marla is a very modest person, but Marla did the stretching of the works and the organizing and curation of this particular exhibition. So just know, she will say, no, it was you, but it really, I just really didn't do anything except for exist, and she did do this, and I will not take other women's credit. Okay, so Akindele John was born in 1995 in the Ogun State in Nigeria. He currently is in Lagos, Nigeria, just moved into a new studio. And his work is focused on women from Africa. And you'll notice there are some very clear characteristics that exist. We'll talk more about that in his works. But is the focus really is on the hair and the regality of being an African woman and existing. And as he continues on, his work just becomes more beautiful. And like I admire his work, but he also is a very kind person as well. And I respect that even more. Next up, we are going to have Debrasha Greye share a performance with us. I'm going to share the bio, and I want a good round of applause when I'm done for this beautiful, brilliant being. Debrasha's love for performing arts was cultivated throughout her involvement in the Milwaukee area dance and theater arts programs, including Art in Motion, City Ballet Theater, Majestica Theater, Lincoln Center of the Arts, Milwaukee High School of the Arts, AMPS, and Brown Deer High School. Seeking to continue her, growth as a performer, Debrasha participated in an intensive study program in DanceWorks in 2012. This opportunity led to teaching experiences with the Mad Hot Ball, Ballroom and Tap, and also work with the United Performing Arts Fund. Additionally, Debrasha studied dance in studios from Latin America all the way to Germany, and it is a real treat to have this wonderful being here today. Thank you for agreeing to work with me. Always a treat. I'm gonna move this out of your way. Oh, this is heavy. forgetting. Okay. And so I'm going to share Destinny Fletcher's bio. Is it Diolinda?
Yes.
All right. So Destinny Fletcher, also known as Diolinda, abstract, a woman of power, a woman with the power to inspire womanhood through the phenomenon of her voice, with Milwaukee, Wisconsin as her hometown, art becomes her sound and greatest enigma. She self-published her latest poetry collection, Black Girl Be the Storm, in May of 2016, Fireflies and Peroxide in May of 2014, and Submerged, I'm Drowning, a new collection that's coming this month. Make sure you support living artists now, and cop a copy of that. She continues to rock stages with the many cities she touched. A spoken word artist, actress, advocate, survivor, representing womanhood, body positivity, and self-awareness. I'll tell you another thing, phenomenal writer off top, like first drafts. I know you said you needed to revise those drafts. So I came and I taught a workshop here working with some students on an ekphrastic situation workshop with these pieces of art, right? And so you're supposed to like write in response to the work and create a narrative for these beings, right, in the subjects of the art. When I tell you, like, they had like 10 minutes to write and it was flames, like she spit hot fire out immediately, I'm like goosebumps. Poetry makes me cry and it also gives me goosebumps, and I definitely was like clutching my pearls or clutching my Nakeysha necklace. So come on up, give a round of applause to Destinny as Destinny makes it to the stage.
No pressure, right? Yeah. All right, so I'm gonna share a couple of poems for you. How y'all doing tonight? Y'all good? Good, good, okay, that's what I like to hear. I like energy, I give out energy as I'm giving, so, okay. All right, so this poem is called Black Woman Rise. A soul like mine, I remember you like a wave, almost fatal, never stern, never too brief, just you. Telling the world that you are unstoppable. Telling the earth to breathe, to become one with your anatomy. We watch you dance into the stone of fire. Kiss the architect they call woman. You love until the sky darkens. You swoon until the sunlight. We used to write poems about you. Skin like crimson. Taunting as if they knew your stories, your shackles, your history. No man can tackle. You are the belly in the beast. The hunger of a thousand songs, the scripture in a baby's thought. I knew you. Knew your strength before thy claimed invincible. Knew your words before they were spoken, for I wrote a poem about you. A free verse so cold the avalanche fell for you. Black and unapologetic, magical and spirituality embedded, we call you woman. Birthing nations and generations with your love bones, causing raptures with your tone. No wonder God made you a place called home. Black woman, I wrote this for you, praying that your lungs give you healing and your feet causes you to roam. You are the gift that they will never own. Black woman, I wrote this for you. Thank you. This poem is called He Called Me the Promised Land. He called me the promised land. Saw the stars within my bosom and the moon inside my womb. Saw the wisdom in my hair. Gave me the wings to fly. Eventually would give me another one just like him. A soul, a purpose, to be God in this flesh. He called me the Promised Land. Spoke it like it was our language. Kissed my belly, made me warm, marveled at my glow, had me stand at attention, called me beautiful. Marveled at my glow, had me stand at attention, y'all, called me beautiful. We were the creators of this chemistry, molded it with our eyes were closed. He gave me something to hope, to inspire, to anticipate. Saw the tornado within my soul and called it wishful thinking. Sang to me so sweet, poured honey in my coffee on Sunday mornings. We laid like this for hours with mamas of sweet somethings, only happy beginnings. He called me the Promised Land, made me believe again in me. Thank you. Two more pieces for y'all, is that cool? Is that cool? Okay. This poem is called Fear. Fear considered me to be its victim today, made me succumb to self-doubt and resentment, made me feel empty, had a plan ready for me to fail. See, fear told me that my heart be broken, that my faith be tried, that my anger be replenished. Fear made me reach out in anguish, left me in misery, stole my happiness, but gave me a purpose for change. See, fear never made it past my comfort. Never gained clarity. Saw the warrior in my stride and the courage in my eyes. My strength be carried during wartime. See, fear tried me today. Left battle wounds and scars, but unlike many others, I grew. Stood my ground. Fear had no casualties. Made me love with my soul. Made me feel with my heart. See, fear ain't got nothing on me. My stature is what you see today, because fear made me whole. Thank you. All right. I'm going to share my favorite piece. but again, thank you guys for having me. It's been such a pleasure. Oh, my goodness. Once again, just these pieces alone, like I've spent a good 2 weeks with a poetry camp with these pieces, and I've marveled, I've cried, I've just, the filling of this room with these pieces. I'm so thankful. Thank you for asking me to do this, seriously. Like, this poem is called I Am Woman, A Declaration to Eartha Kitt, Nina Simone, and Grace Jones. I am woman. Canceled by your fears and your doubts, do you speak diction? Has your words ever carried oceans and planted islands? Does your memories provide notion? Is it a world without me in it? You will remember me in your heart. Your veins will pump my energy and your lips will speak my truth. I am not afraid of you. Of him, of her. Do not proclaim my charisma for weakness. Be relevant when you speak of me. I am God to the blessing you speak of. The earth is within my name. Speak it, own it. I am woman. Misunderstood by many. Do not ask me to glow for you. My smile is not for sale. My soul is not for auction, and I'd be damned if the Mississippi River does not flow within me. Who are you to tell me that I was not born to be God? Who are you to sanction my art for your glory? I am sinner, but you are not my master. You are not my sanctuary. You will remember me and your music. I am your tyrant and your serenity, blazing through your speakers, spiraling through your propaganda, such a complicated creature. I am woman, hurricane and fierce, lavender and blue, rock and roll to soul. What you seek is fire within my bones. Do not call me ugly. Do not tone down my voice, my words, my attitude. This was never made for your enjoyment. Flip you the bird, call it what you will, baby. I am the revolution. You will remember me. Here I am, black woman, power, God, femininity, love, or leave me. Thank you so much for your time.
I have goosebumps because that's, I'm telling you, poetry was my first love. Yes, thank you so much. Thank both of you so much. Just yes, hold on, I need a moment to compose myself. That's why I love poetry, creativity exists. Like, there's so much in just creativity itself. Like, I am not a religious woman, and if I were, like, I would say that the ability to create, the ability to create is the epitome of divinity for me. And that is like, that would be my altar, is just the ability to create and bring something forth out of nothing. And seeing these things and these creative beings and this art in each of you, that's creativity. So thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you all again. So, I got to do a really cool thing starting last January. We really started planning it with Kintera like last July. So, I had the opportunity to create a residency in partnership with the Milwaukee Art Museum and a foundation called Critical Thinking, right? Oh, I said the wrong thing. Critical thinking is my English teacher thing. Critical minded, pardon me. Yes, critical minded. So the residency is called Revolutionary Art Criticism Residency. And these three beautiful beings right in the front are three of our participants. And like I said, it was created in partnership with Fatima Laster and Cantera. I have the very distinct privilege to come up with the curriculum and also work one-on-one with these writers and their writing. And so today, they're going to be our panel and they're going to discuss the art. But I'm gonna read the official spiel off the paper, so just deal with me. All right, so Revolutionary Art Criticism Residency is designed by Genre Urban Arts and facilitated by me. It injects the voices of black and brown writers into art criticism and art writing, ensuring that these spaces are more equitable and provide a more truthful depiction of the story of art. This project is supported by Critical Minded, an initiative to invest in cultural critics of color, co-founded by the Nathan Cummings Foundation and the Ford Foundation and the Milwaukee Art Museum. So without further ado, what I'm gonna ask you guys is just to bring the chairs that you have up. And then we need to, can we move this podium out of the way? We have a couple changes, guys, sorry. And while we're doing this, I'm just gonna keep talking. We can leave this one up for a moment. I'm just gonna keep talking so we can kind of organize ourselves. So our speakers today, we need that other microphone out of the corner. Our participants are Akira, Akira is a multimedia artist, a muralist, writer, and a culture commentator. We have Amanda Ruby. Amanda also says, also known as Amanda and by a few other names. Amanda is a Boricua woman, born and raised in Milwaukee. Amanda is a creator in visual arts and is an amazing writer. This is not fully true. I'm privy to actually read your articles and also wonderful fiction pieces that are like very deep and really show this mind of a being who does not, she also is modest, too modest. And then we have Brittany Walker. Brittany is an employee at the Milwaukee Art Museum, a doting mother, and a steward and shop chair for the IAMAW, so the union person. Very vocal. You're gonna hear, if there's an issue, you're gonna hear about it from Brittany and the action will follow. An artist who paints with therapeutic purpose, a true believer using the brush in addition to journaling as a tool to sustain mental stability. And also another great writer, three wonderful writers and brilliant thinkers here. And so what they're gonna do now is they're gonna discuss these works and I'm just gonna let you guys get to it. You got this good. You gotta use the mic.
Are we gonna sit or? Oh, okay. We'll get started. Can you guys all hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah, great. So we kind of want to have like an interactive conversation here, so we'll be asking you questions along the way, but we'll start with what did you all notice when you first kind of viewed the works here with the pattern? Anyone want to share? Anyone else want to share what they first noticed? I think they got another one.
Skin color.
Skin color? Awesome. Thank you, Debrasha.
Halos.
Halos. Awesome. Great.
They all have that same
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
The color is flowing rather than being still.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, those are all really great points, and I think we can kind of speak to some of those a little bit. Does anyone, either of you want to start?
Yeah,
this works. Oh, awesome. I'm sorry.
I just love how it's the same person in different forms. Mm-hmm. The multi, the complicity of being the same but being different at the same
right,
time.
Right, right.
And they don't make eye contact with the viewer.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, I noticed that as well.
It's interesting, you mentioned that they were the same person, but I didn't see them as the same person. I saw like the halo and the nose rings being something that made them look similar, but I actually thought they might be different people. So it's interesting you said that because it's making me see them differently.
Okay. Any specific, oh.
I actually didn't notice the halo part. I thought it was light reflection. I thought that was they were trying to show a sense of light onto the person. Mm-hmm. So I really think that.
Awesome.
Any specific feelings? Like, I know for me, when I walked into this space, there was a sense of glory, a sense of truth, a truth that isn't so often told. Was there any feelings about the exhibition?
I'm gonna be honest, I just appreciate how beautiful black skin looked in as a portrait, to be mm-hmm. honest.
Me personally too, this painting right here with the pink background, when I first saw her, I immediately thought she was pregnant because of where her hand is sitting. Mm-hmm. So that just gave me mother, that gave me birth, that gave me everything, so.
Yeah. But yes, I was saying that I had shared with Nakeysha that this was my favorite painting out of all of them. The fact that I see so much color, that you can see so much detail in the way that the face is created, but there's so many frills out of the fabric and all the color, and the fact that she's holding a flower and she just looks so delicate, so motherly, ready to bring something forth. And it feels, that's what it feels in this space, like something is being birthed and something beautiful is being brought forth.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, all really great observations. Were you gonna say something, Brittany?
I was just gonna speak to the person that thought of the objects as moving. Mm-hmm. Because I felt that same exact way, as if, I mean, we all look at paintings and for the most part, they are standing still. But the fact that most of these, if not all of these women, are in movement, it makes me feel like there's a symbolic message there. I'm not sure if anyone else feels that way, but I truly felt that.
I think for me, the most captivating picture is the one that's not obvious, is the one behind us. Mm-hmm. There's something about a duality
right. Of
a woman that, as a black man, I've just learned on to as dealing with my wife, right? So it looks to be on one end, she's as bright as day and happy, but in the same sense, it could be something else that we don't see or know
right
there. Mm-hmm. So that one is the most intriguing to me, only because we're covering more than just the beauty in mm-hmm. the object, but there's a sense of pain
right. Or
a sense of hurting on the opposite side of the beauty. Mm-hmm. So that one to me speaks the most.
Yeah, I'm glad you bring that one up. That one I felt like had a sense of like past and present between the more shadowy figure at the behind and the brighter figure kind of more present and happy in the front.
Yeah, I think Akindele definitely captures black women in a very aesthetically pleasing way. The colors, and even, I love the fact that they're even wearing their afros, because it's such a significant thing for the black community to rock our natural hair, you know, due to, you know, white supremacy telling us our hair is not beautiful. And I even think about the hair related to, like, nature, and you know how nature usually, like, it creates, it's always a balance, you know, it nurtures you, it heals you, it feeds you. And I feel like even with that, I didn't recognize, like, someone mentioned about her, the figure being pregnant too. So thinking deeply about that, even tying it with nature too. But yeah, and even with the little flowers, like, you see in there too, also go with the theme of nature and these different objects. I wonder what these objects mean to the figure. Mm-hmm. And what do y'all think about the objects? Like the books, the mug, what do y'all think? Someone back there.
When I saw the pictures and I looked at the different objects, it's like each object is a form of peace. You know, like reading, you find tranquility and peace. The dove, I do believe that's a dove. And the flowers, it just reminds me of something that we as women, we value and we find beauty and peace in it when we want our quiet time and reflecting on ourselves. So that's why I
understand. I definitely see the objects as a distinction. Like, she's going places. You know, she's never stagnant.
Right.
That's exactly what I see.
Hi,
For me, the objects that they're holding is a failed focus. You know, usually when you're holding something right up front, the focus is right on what is being held. But everything else that's happening is so beautiful and it's so joyful. And it's like something is being brought forth. That's what I said at first. So you don't even see or pay attention to what's being held because it just becomes like something other than everything else that's taking place. So I see it as something that maybe would have traditionally been looked as a focal point, but it's completely missed by the beauty that is being represented in the image.
That's fair. Yeah, someone mentioned the texture and the difference of the flat and the, with the different paint styles. I thought that was really interesting. As far as I can tell, his mediums are acrylic paint and oil paint. And for me as a painter, I a lot of times layer things to get that depth of color, and I think he did a really great job in doing that in these works.
And I had an observation of what she's holding real quickly. I think they're characteristics of the being in the picture. Mm-hmm. Dove is often seen as peace, yep. Right? So in those pictures, I don't see the bird. I see the bird as a representation of the person in the picture. Okay. She's at peace. Or she is peace, depending on how you look at it, right? Right. So I see all the items she's holding as different characteristics. She's smart, she's brilliant, mm-hmm. She's joyful, she's all the different things, and these things she's holding just gives you an insight as to who she is outside the picture.
I completely agree. For me, I thought the same thing. I felt like each of these subjects were painted in a graceful manner in which Black women aren't usually depicted in that way. And that was very important for me. The fact that each and every one of them seems more dainty than what the public depicts us. So I felt like that was a proper representation. For another perspective of what Black women bring to the table, mm-hmm. How we are truly, and not what, you know, what the public depicts us as.
I was gonna say this, I don't know if y'all planned this or not, but y'all look so beautiful up there. Like, I'm seeing the portraits, and I'm also seeing y'all, like the colors, like everything, and I love, first of all, just the imagery that is of Black skin. So literally just seeing y'all up there, it's so beautiful.
Thank you.
It's just looking at it from this angle, it's beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you.
What's funny is I'm anal about appearance to an extent. I was gonna ask them, like, what are you guys wearing? So we can kind of, but also what I do know, especially in the short time of us knowing each other, there's a sense of like, I don't know, there's a connection here that I didn't know existed until we started these exchanges more often. Mm-hmm. And we feed off of each other without that verbal. It truly is.
Basically.
It truly is. And when I walked through the door, I said, oh, I didn't have anything to worry about. We were already on the same page. Thanks for confirming it. But anyhow, that's what I was thinking, that these women were painted in a way that I truly see us as, and mm-hmm. I feel like it's important that the public sees that as well. Also for me, the fact that they were also painted in a very docile way was interesting to me as well. Because Black women are inferior, they can be docile, but that is not the way society allows us to be. we don't have that freedom to be docile or as soft as we'd like to be in most cases. So that was important to me as well. But I was wondering what you all thought about that, if you had thoughts or.
Yeah, so there's a few things. Two, the scale matters. When you walk in this room, the scale of these paintings puts the viewer at a position where we have to look up at them, which I think is something that's very important. And the more that I'm in this room, I just got chills, but The more that I'm in this room and I look at each individual painting, the expression on each of the woman's faces is entirely different, mm-hmm. which to me reads as an emotion, a range of feelings. Like this one, well, maybe that one is like side eye, you know? And this one is, I don't know, it feels very whimsical and like childlike. And so I think the scale and the expression is important in this.
True.
Very true. Yeah. It allows us to look like more in depth with it, because if it was more small scale, then it would be hard to really like take in the piece. So that's a good thing to point out. And one thing I also noticed about the piece is like, I like the fact that they have different hair styles too. Like, you can see this in many black women. You can see them rocking their big fro, their short fro, their TWA, you know, the teeny weeny afro, if no one knows. So I think that's amazing to capture those different stages of that figure too. And maybe this is even different stages of the figure's life too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah.
She told me to say something. I don't have anything planned. I'm just honoring my daughter's request. But on that note, I will say, our poet tonight, can you tell me your name again? Destiny. Destiny was talking about the three of you and how beautifully you match the images. But I was also thinking that if I look around the room as well, like all the black women here look like they stepped off the canvas. Yeah. And so, yeah. And so part of me, this goes back to the idea of the black women looking the same, but also variations. Like there's a way in which he seems to naturally paint an affinity. And
did you want to say anything?
Uh-huh.
And also, thank you for the program, because it also made my daughter super excited to see the black dancer in the room and like how eager,
yes.
how eager she was to watch you. So thank you.
Thanks, Bolanle. We appreciate your participation.
Yes.
So. One, I love how the artist can depict power, but also depict softness at the same time. It's really hard to do. And this one in front of it just screams power, but also screams love at the same time, mm-hmm. which is beautiful just to see in a painting with also a black person in it.
Someone mentioned that they noticed that the subjects are not directly looking at the viewer. Do you guys have any thoughts on what that might mean or how that made you feel?
For me, it also screams power. Like I am it. Mm-hmm. pay attention, focus on me. Like all attention and eyes should be on me. Watch what I do next. You mm-hmm. know what I mean? As it should, well, very well should be. Mm-hmm. I think he painted black women, especially the gaze, especially the focus, in a way where society sees us, but is too afraid to say it, you know? Because these are true enough people or space or women who will take up any space, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
To share a space is enough. It's overwhelming because they are all very much, you know, it. So for that, it's not for the painting to focus on the viewer. It's for the viewer to focus on the painting.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yep. Well, I was thinking of it like she's in her own natural state, like you were saying, like, and also mind, you know how we be minding our business too, like, and for real, she's like in her own state, and like we as an audience are all up in her space too in some way, like looking at her, and she's just doing her own thing and living her best life, like, you know?
Yeah, I found it really skillful of Akindele to paint these women in that way. I find that it's often harder for men to paint women in that way, that is very realistic of who they are. Does anyone else from the audience have any thoughts on that in terms of like the male gaze and painting as a male painting females?
I don't think there is room for like that in this space because he did such a good job. I think if we saw something of the sense of misogynistic or sexist, you know, there would be more of a space to talk about that. But I think because he executed it in that way, doesn't leave much room for, you know, criticism on that note. But yeah, I agree.
Okay.
And I think the large scale is the only way to paint these people or these women. I don't think a small canvas would have did this justice at all.
Yeah.
Because we take up space anyhow. So he did right with the large scale to address the large scale paintings.
And I'm curious to see Akindele paint other different black women because there's so many different black women that come in different sizes, you know, height, everything. Age, that part. Like, I see so many, like, it's hard to put black women in a box. So I wonder what he can do with his art, like, with his portfolio going forward. Right. Yeah.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what he brings next.
Yeah. And even maybe little kids too, you know?
Absolutely.
Like, yeah, you know?
I'd like to appreciate again once, like, the power that is on the canvas. Just also too, like, she here. Like, it's literally even like with you saying not looking at anybody but knowing that I see you, you see me, and she deserves to be in this space. And I think a lot of people get very questionable when it comes to a black woman when they first enter the room, everybody looks at her. And that's exactly what these canvases look at. It's when she walk in the room, that's her. Mm-hmm. You see her. Everybody stop. That's her.
Absolutely. And the fact that they look so similar just speaks volumes to us, you know, being strong representations of each other. You know, I am every woman is like in each and every one of these paintings. Yeah, there's a strong, like, ancestral or some type of, there's definitely a connection, more or less, but a lineage, if you will, that's present within all of us, but he just made it more apparent with these paintings. I think it's for us to acknowledge that in a sense, you know what I mean? Like, to leave here knowing that we are sisters more so than strangers.
Definitely. And what does everyone think about the halo, like the symbolism behind that?
Is it okay that my comment isn't about the halo? I'm gonna go like super far back and say that the feeling that I have when I'm looking at the work is about seeing yourself in art. I had a choreographer say to me once that when you're on the stage, people are looking for themselves in what you're doing, whether it's the shapes that you're doing or whatever it is, and to look at art and look and really process that, oh, I really am looking for myself in this work right now. And I think when I walked in here, and I don't think I noticed that they weren't looking at you, but to think that they're not looking at me lets me think that this person can be whoever I think it is. I can know this person, even though it's not them. I know this person, and I can see it through the way that they carry themselves and the makeup of them in the image.
I have a question for you. I was wondering if you based your costuming and your choreography on the pieces.
Yeah.
No, and I asked that because as you were talking about looking for yourself in the work, I was looking for the paintings in your choreography.
Yeah.
So I felt like I saw moments where you embodied a bird or you embodied peace. So I was wondering if you could speak to that.
Absolutely. Probably about a week ago, I was having a panic attack because how could I let the work live through what I was going to put together? And I connected with a colleague of mine and said, just be inspired by what you see. So shout out to Nakeysha for letting me get in here earlier this week. And yes, costume, jewelry, movement, et cetera, is all based on this work.
Yes. Okay.
For me, these were black patron saints. These were goddesses, if you will. These are subjects to worship, you know? That's how I felt. But and with Akindele's close kinship to Christianity, patron saints are, of course, Catholic, but I believe, you know, there was a sense of paying homage to things spiritual in this work, mm-hmm. in this body of work.
Yeah, I totally agree. I like the movement of the paint strokes and kind of definitely embodies that as well. Mm-hmm. Yes.
I didn't think they were halos at first. I thought they were sunrises. I thought it was just like a symbolization of a bringing of a new day. Same person, but different you. It seems like they have different expressions in every single one, so I thought it was a different day and the same person.
The circle behind them was the first thing that I noticed when I started to look at all the work. And as I started to get closer to each one of the paintings, I noticed that the artist didn't draw the background, you know, as he made her, but rather he started with the background first and then started to paint her. So it could be that the inspiration starts with the color, with that circle, and then from then on, trying to bring to life this woman that he keeps portraying in so many different ways to life.
Mm-hmm. I'm also with him when you say it looks like the sun, because we know that we soak up the sun. Melanin.
Oh, that right? part. Yep. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
Now that's where I'm coming from with it. That's exactly what I'm seeing here.
Okay. Very good point.
That's a fair observation.
Yeah. And it's interesting. Oh.
Sorry.
Okay. I was just gonna say real quick, it's interesting to hear everybody's different perspectives on how they interpret the art too. And you begin to open your eyes right. more further about the art too. Like, oh, I didn't think about it in that way. I'm like, that's deep. Like, yeah.
No, I was thinking the same. With the sun, it makes me think mm-hmm. the sun sets and rises on you or for you in your name, mm-hmm. that type of way.
Yeah,
so that's where I was. I'm like, yeah, I love the interpretations and the different perspectives. It's allowing me to see the work in new eyes. Anything else from anyone?
Yeah, are there any questions from the audience?
Anything virtually?
Oh, yeah, good point.
I just had more comment about the painting. Dang, I forgot. Sorry. As soon as I thought of it, I instantly forgot. I'm sorry. Oh, the sun rises again. I just remembered. It's an interesting focal point. It's really each one of them, you can see your eyes going straight to it. So you make sure you look at the face. Mm-hmm. You make sure you notice the face because it's right at that focal point. And it's really the brightest thing on the painting is the sunrise or halo. Is the brightest thing, and the fact that her face is right in front of it is just like, you see me, you notice me, you know who I am.
Yeah. Call me by my name. Right. I am woman. Yes. All of these. Yes.
And speaking of the halo, what do y'all think about this oval around this figure? Like,
I love
it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Simple.
Definitely. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it really goes with facial expression too.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Definitely.
I hope I'm not the only one that thinks she's standing by a body of water in this one.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Okay. You know, just making sure.
And it, and like the beach, like the sunrise when y'all like the thing, that's why I like the water, the ocean. Mm-hmm. So yeah,
it just again about the lake theory, it just looks like you ever been out in the country and there's plenty of stars, plenty of lights, and it's just a very dark night out. But you see, it's just, it looks like that's what the background is. She's just, there's no pollution, there's no city, there's just her and nature.
To be honest, and I don't know if anybody picked this up because I know specifically that this isn't, the painting specifically isn't from here. Mm-hmm. But these two with the dress, it gave me a New Orleans feeling.
Okay.
And I don't know if it gave anybody else that, but it kind of gave me like the old New Orleans Renaissance type of thing too.
Mm-hmm. I feel that.
Anybody else?
Any questions for us from the audience or virtually anyone watching on Crowdcast? No.
Okay. Well, thank you all for being here and.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, I appreciate this conversation, this open discussion about the work. It's so important for us to have conversations like this. Honestly, mm-hmm. It feeds the soul for me.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone.
Yes, thank you.
We want to thank our sponsors, Critical Minded, Milwaukee Art Museum, Genre Urban Art Space, and Woodland Pattern.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That concludes the event. Please feel free to hang around for a little while. Check out the art. The works are also for sale, so purchase art. And also follow us on social media, Genre Urban Arts. If you find me or Woodland Pattern, then you can find all the rest of our people. Thank you so much for spending your time with us this evening. And you can see why working with them has been amazing. Like, we have conversations just about art, just about existing in black and brown bodies all the time. And it's been the five people who are in our group, it's been an amazing experience to just have the safety of existing and talking about these things are bothering me, because it's not always a safe place to speak about those things. So I love them. I love them. I love them. Thank you all. Thank you all for coming. And it's good to see your beautiful faces. Have a good night.